Now to the crisis in Haiti. It has been less than a week since the shocking assassination of Haiti's president by gunmen who broke into his home. Now a possible conspiracy involving a Haitian-born doctor living in Florida has further roiled an already fraught situation. All this as political rivals jockey for power. There is now a new lead suspect in the assassination of President Jovenel Moïse. Haitian authorities said over the weekend that he is this man, 63-year-old Christian Emmanuel Sanon, a Haitian-American who lives in Florida. In 2011, he appeared to promote himself as a leader for Haiti.
With me in power, you're going to have to tell me, what are you doing with my uranium? What you going to do with the oil that we have in the country? What you going to do with the gold that you want to explore?
Police Chief Leon Charles said Sanon had arrived in Haiti in June. In a search of Sanon's home, officers found weapons, bullets, and a hat with an emblem from the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration. Video shot at the scene of the crime appeared to show someone purporting to be a DEA agent. Charles said Sanon was in police custody.
He arrived in Haiti on a private airplane to fulfill political objective. He has contacted a company specializing in security to recruit some bandits.
Haitian authorities have arrested 23 Colombians and two Haitian Americans they say carried out the attack. Colombia's police chief said a Florida-based security company, CTU, bought 19 plane tickets for the Colombian assailants, many of whom were retired soldiers. The tickets were from Bogota, Colombia, to Santo Domingo in the Dominican Republic. From there, the assailants allegedly crossed over the border into Haiti. Meanwhile, the power struggle continued in Haiti. Two men each say they are the rightful prime minister of Haiti. Claude Joseph had the role when Moïse was killed, but his successor, Ariel Henry, was supposed to take over that day. Joseph's opponents are already calling for his ouster.
We consider him as a usurper who should be in jail.
Remaining members of the mostly disbanded Haitian Senate voted on their leader, Joseph Lambert, to serve as acting president. The White House said a U.S. delegation met with all three men on Sunday. Haiti's powerful gangs also seem to be taking advantage of the power vacuum. Notorious leader Jimmy Cherizier, known as Barbecue, urged gangs to avenge the president's death.
Mobilisez. I ask all the gangs to mobilize, take to the streets. We demand explanations about the assassination of the president.
Port-au-Prince resident Yvens Rumbold said that Moïse's murder has led to fear on the streets.
The feeling is, if the president can be assassinated at his home, so everything can happen to anyone in this country.
In the midst of the chaos, Haiti still has presidential elections, which the United States says should proceed. President Biden spoke this afternoon.
The people of Haiti deserve peace and security, and Haiti's political leaders need to come together for the good of their country.
We turn now to Eduardo Gamarra, professor of political science at Florida International University. He has written widely on Haiti, the Caribbean, and Latin America. Professor Gamarra, thank you so much for talking with us. First of all, what do you make of this new information about the Haitian-American who says he's a doctor living in Florida, who's now been arrested?
Well, I think it signifies more than anything else the wide net of conspiracy that really led to the murder of President Moïse. And it also involves, obviously, a significant component of the Haitian private sector. This man, other than saying he's a doctor, also claims to be a business person. So that probably leads to a whole series of other names that will come up in the next few days that will help us more readily identify who financed this operation.
You mentioned the Haitian private sector, the business community in Haiti. What would be the motive for them to get rid of President Moïse?
Well, the unfortunate fact is that President Moïse was unpopular across the spectrum in Haiti. But he also stepped on a few toes in the private sector, was facing the wrath of some of the most important business people who not only were his political opponents, but who also, in essence, pledged to have him removed.
And what you're saying is it may be difficult to draw a line between what they may have said about him and what finally happened to him.
Exactly. That's the most difficult part to decipher. And so I think that, you know, in a sense, there were so many different, gangs already in place in Haiti, funded by different actors. Gangs are related to drug trafficking, simple gangs related to street neighborhoods, for example. But also, and this is very important, a pattern that we had begun seeing in Haiti around the turn of the century of foreign security teams coming in to provide different sorts of security for ministers, for the president, or for the private sector, for that matter.
Do you think Haiti law enforcement will ultimately get to the bottom of who did this?
Well, what's surprising is that given the weakness of the non-existent judiciary, but also the fact that the police is essentially dismantled, that they got to so quickly to the culprits, that they arrested so many of the mercenaries, and that they are really moving fairly quickly in terms of finding out who financed this operation.
Professor Gamarra, what about the political piece of this? There are now, what, three people, different people, who are saying they should be in charge, who may be laying claim to being prime minister. Where do you see this? How do you see this playing itself out?
This is going to be probably determined largely by who the international community supports. And as of right now, it has been the prime minister who was nominated in April, but who was essentially replaced by President Moïse on Monday of last week. But the international community is putting their support behind that gentleman, Mr. Joseph. So I imagine that that's where the direction, at least politically, that Haiti will take. But again, even in that context, holding elections in Haiti, which I think is what the international community expects, is going to be difficult given the fact that things are so unraveled at the moment and that really there appears to be chaos, at least in Port-au-Prince.
I was struck that you told my colleague, our producer, Dan Segallen, that when he asked you if Haiti's a failed state, you said you can't have a failed state when there's no state. I mean, did you mean that?
Yes. Unfortunately, Haiti has been in a very precarious situation in terms of institution building, and probably going back since the collapse of the Duvalier regime in the middle of the 1980s. This is a transition to democracy that never really gelled, that never was able to produce political parties, stable institutions, even a constitutional regime. And in the context of natural resource, natural catastrophes and recurring political crises, what you've had is complete political implosion. And so here we are now with two prime ministers who, in a parliamentary system that, with a parliament that doesn't exist, with a judiciary that's collapsed, with a police that's essentially half of what it used to be 4 years ago, with no armed forces, with no institutionality, it's very difficult to see the presence of a state.
Such a difficult set of circumstances. Professor Eduardo Gamarra, Florida International University, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Judy.